Father, I thank you for this time. I ask you, Lord, that you would continue to have your way in and through our lives. Jesus, I pray that the Holy Spirit may be with us thick tonight, that we may recognize and that we may know that we have a God in heaven who loves us. I ask you, Lord, that you would just remove any wicked way within us, Lord. Father God, continue to develop within us a broken heart and contrite spirit over sin, over that which breaks your heart. Lord, we love you. And I ask you that you would continue to be with this church. I pray that you'd be with our pastor, Raul, Lord, as he is having such a heavy month. So busy, Lord, but we know that you give more grace, you give more strength. I ask you, Lord, that you would open up this text to us, that it would penetrate our hearts, Lord, and that tonight we may leave different, Father God, than the way we first came. That the Holy Spirit may get a hold of our hearts, change us from within, shaping us and molding us into your image. We love you, and we praise you for all that you've done thus far. Continue to go before us. In Jesus' name we pray. And together we said, amen. Amen. You guys, the book of 1 Kings is an amazing book. You know, it's a book that I hold dear to my heart. There's so many practical things. There's so many practical applications of things that you can draw out of this book. And as we go through this, my prayer is that at the end of the study that we would have a few things in our life. That one, we not only would be encouraged through the Word of God, but that two, we would be encouraged and that also we would be convicted. I know in my own personal life, without the conviction of God in my life, we would be so far off, right? We need a convicting spirit within us. We need the Lord to tell us when we are wrong, because so many times we are wrong. This is an amazing book. This is an amazing chapter. Let me give you a little bit of background on what's going on here in 1 Kings chapter 12. If you're taking notes, the title of my message is going to be a deadly convenience. A deadly convenience. We're going to talk a little bit about what it means to worship God in our own way, in a way that is convenient to us. That's a false way. But what's going on here in the book of 1 Kings is we have the kingdom of Israel being divided. Now, it's crazy. We understand that the nation of Israel, God birthed it, right? He's made a promise to Abraham, and eventually down through his descendants, through his seed, there'd be one nation, a people of God, who he was going to use in the world to shed light and salt upon the Gentiles to bring them to salvation. But we know that the nation of Israel rejected true light, that they continually fell into the sin of harlotry, idolatry, and prostitution with other gods. And the Bible makes it very clear in the New Testament that everything written in the Old Testament was what? Written for our example. So I love going to the Old Testament, drawing from texts like this to practically apply these things to our life because they're written for our example, right? I know the Bible makes it very clear. There's a portion of Scripture that says we need the Word of God continually in our life as a way of reminder. As a way of reminder, we're always needing to be reminded. And there's going to be a principle in this text, in the study tonight, that I pray we would be able to examine our lives in truth and recognize to see if we are in error or if we are right. I believe that in the church, in the day and age in which we live now, there are many who are in error. There are many who are in error when it comes to worshiping God in spirit and in truth. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Background for what's going on here. We have one nation, Israel. And at this time, King Solomon in past chapters has actually died. We all know who King Solomon was. He was King David's, Israel's great king, whom God raised up after his own heart. Solomon was now David's successor. And Solomon was a man who was what? Endowed with amazing, amazing wisdom. Wisdom to be able to deal practically with the people and judging matters from the left and to the right, being able to govern the nation with the power of God, with great understanding. And this was the man of Solomon. But with that wisdom and that knowledge came pride. And eventually, Solomon fell. He fell because with all of his wisdom, with all of his fame that he collected, he hoarded gold. He allowed gold. He allowed the things of this world. And mainly, he allowed women who were not given over to the living God of the Bible, Yahweh, and he allowed these women to corrupt his heart and mind. And so Solomon falls into disobedience towards the end of his life, as so many of us do. That's why the Bible encourages you and I constantly to finish the race, that we would walk in the fruit that God has laid before us, those good works that God has laid before us to do, to walk in. That we would finish the race, that we would hear those amazing words in time to come, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And guys, you have to believe that that is God's aim for you and I. But here we have a man, an example of somebody who finished poorly. And so now God raises up his son, Solomon's son. And so we're like, okay, poor king, now what's his son gonna do? And his son's name is Rehoboam. And Rehoboam is a successor to his father. And at this time, what God has done is the people have now made themselves available to Rehoboam. They're thinking, okay, Solomon lived in luxury. He had the fat pad. He had all the gold, all the money. He built the temple of God. He built his own house, which took longer to build the temple of God. And all this work throughout his whole lifetime, building an amazing throne for himself. But what does it take to build up an amazing empire, an amazing dynasty? It takes people, and it takes labor. And so what happened with the people is they became very tired and very beat down because Solomon had a heavy yoke upon the people. And that yoke was them being completely taxed monetarily and financially. And so he dies and they come to his son and they're thinking maybe, just maybe, we can get a little bit of a rest from Solomon's son. So they approach him. Not only do the people approach him as he's now the new king, a man by the name of Jeroboam, who used to be one of Solomon's regiments who helped him build the city, this guy of great valor who comes with the people and they ask this new king, do you think that you can make our yoke a little lighter? We've been working all these years as your father has been king. We're tired. Do you think maybe we can live in a society, in a kingdom where it's not going to be as difficult? And so Rehoboam thinks about it as new king, and now we're all on the edge of our toes. We're at the edge of the cliff. What's he going to say, this new king? How is he going to be with us? How is he going to treat us? Is he going to be as Jesus was? What does the Bible say about Jesus? That his yoke is easy, that he's lowly, right? Humble in spirit. That's a good king, a king who serves the people. But what happens? Rehoboam sits back. He asks counsel of the men who were around his father at the time when he was alive. He said, what do you guys think I should do with the nation of Israel, with these people? They're asking that I lighten the load. And they say, if you would speak good words to these people, just speak good words, be kindly to them, lighten their yoke, and they will be good to you. And he thinks about it, and he says, I reject that advice. And so he says, you know what? Why don't you call my buddies who I grew up with? Isn't that kind of a picturesque of some of us? We go to our friends who we grew up with. A lot of times we go to people who we know are going to actually pat us on the back and agree with us, right? This is what he's doing. Rejected their advice, and he brings his buddies who he grew up with. And he said, what do you guys think I should do with these people? And they say, man, you know what? Tax them. Make it even harder. And put a heavier yoke than your father put on them. And he says, my little pinky shall be thicker than my father's waist. And I'm going to press down upon you people. You're asking for peace. You're not going to get it. So that goes down. And the people naturally what? Become upset and they rebel. And Rehoboam sends one of his advisors, Adoram, who was in charge of the revenue. But all Israel, the Bible says, stone this man. And it is through this event, and best believe, understand, this is God's sovereign hand over this whole situation. Because that man, Jeroboam, who I talked about, who came with the nation of Israel to this king and asked him for peace, God said in time past that he was actually going to be one of the new kings of Israel, because God foresaw with his sovereignty that the nation was going to be divided. And it was through this event, the nation was divided. And what happens, they killed him and they rebel. And Rehoboam says, you killed my advisor, and he's going to go down to Jerusalem and wage a mighty war against now 10 nations. The nation of Israel was split, divided between 12 nations. Because of this division, because of his rebellion against the people, the nation split. So you have the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. In the northern kingdom, we have 10 tribes. In the southern, 2, Benjamin and Judah. The wicked king who denied the people from giving them rest on all sides, Rehoboam, was in Judah. And remember, in Judah is the temple of God, where the temple was erected, where men and women were called to come and worship. And he wants to make war. God stops him. They don't make war. So now we got a kingdom divided of Jeroboam ruling the 10 tribes of Israel and Rehoboam on the bottom, ruling and reigning over the southern tribes. So that's where we're at. So now we're caught up, and what, we have peace between the two nations? Well, let's see if these kings are gonna rule with a good rule within their heart, with the God of Israel upon the forefront of their mind doing his will, but we know it doesn't happen. And so we get into 1 Kings chapter 12 and verse 25. And remember, we're speaking in this study tonight concerning a convenience, a deadly convenience, something that is made easy. And we read in verse 25, then Jeroboam, who was the king of the north of the 12 tribes, built Shechem in the mountains of Ephraim and dwelt there. Also, he went out from there and built Penuel. And Jeroboam said within his heart, now the kingdom may return to the house of David. If these people go up to offer sacrifices in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then the heart of this people will turn back to their Lord Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they will kill me and go back to Rehoboam, king of Judah. Verse 28, therefore the king asked advice, made 2 calves of gold, and said to the people, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Here are your gods, O Israel, which brought you up out of the land of Egypt. So what happened here? What did he say? So he's in the north ruling over the 10 tribes. And in the southern kingdom, the divided kingdom, Judah and Benjamin, in that nation is Jerusalem, where the temple's at. You see, the people, though the nation was divided, were still obligated under the law of Moses to go to the temple and still lift up sacrifices and worship unto the Lord. For it was in Old Testament time that worship, the worship of God, was located centrally in one place. And so now he's thinking back within his heart, well, if the people go back up to Jerusalem, which is actually lower geographically, if they go up to Jerusalem to worship the Lord, they might possibly have their hearts turned back over to Rehoboam, and they might kill me. So what does he do? He makes it very convenient for the people to, instead of going up to Jerusalem and trekking and making that pilgrimage down there every year, what does he do? He says, I'll put a golden calf, I'll make the shrine of a golden calf, and this will be your God. And you can worship it here, and I'll make it closer to where you guys are at. Not only will I do that, I'll make 2 golden calves. One about right here, one about right here. So you guys don't have to come all the way down here to Jerusalem, and you can just worship these. Imagine that was our mindset for worshiping the living God. That we were to think, well, it's kind of inconvenient for me to do the things that God calls me to do in his word where he requires worship of me. So I'll devise my own religion, make up my own gods, and I'll worship those. And I'll worship those. Jesus says what? There comes a time when you shall worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And Jeroboam made a convenient way for the people to worship according to the dictates of his own heart. He raised up these false gods, these golden calves, just like Aaron did in the wilderness, and says, these are your gods. which are not God's at all, according to the dictates of his own heart. You guys, we've heard it before. Your heart and my heart, the Bible makes it very clear, is desperately wicked. It's evil. Our heart is bent on doing that which is going to satisfy our flesh, make it easy. We naturally as a people like to do that which makes our life easy. No one likes to be put in a situation in their life where things are difficult. I know I certainly don't. But the Bible makes it very clear that when we're put in places of difficulty, when we're put in places of trial, where anxiety can preside over our life for whatever given reason, those are the times that God uses us tremendously if we would seek him by faith. If we would seek him by faith. But this man, as this wicked leader, has raised up these calves to what? To draw people away from Rehoboam so they don't worship him and give their allegiance to him. Not only draw people away from him, but draw people away from what? From the temple of God where God is. Draw them away from the living God. Whose aim is that for your life? Satan. For your life and my life, Satan's aim is to draw you away from the temple of God or from the presence of God, where the presence of God is, unto something else which is not a God at all. That is his aim. What is the definition of doing something or having something that is convenient for you in your life? Just the plain definition of convenience is what? Is something that involves little trouble or effort. Little trouble or effort. Or something that is situated as to allow easy access. Something that is situated as to allow easy access. And this was it, that he would draw people away from the temple. So listen, so what did he do? So he made, and I want you guys to catch this and understand this, and take this in your mind and dwell upon it. He made his own gods, golden calves, closer to home, as to allow the people to get closer, so that the people wouldn't get closer to Rehoboam and ultimately God. But remember this, guys, and understand this. These idols that he raised up for them to worship and bow down to, which God called them not to, it was gold. Everything that glitters in your life or everything that has some type of allurement, even if it's in church, there could be an allure, an attraction to where you may say, I feel that the presence of God is here just by what you see. But not everything that glitters and sparkles might be gold. You and I have to have spiritual discernment to be able to tell what is true and what is false. And that spiritual discernment only comes when we worship God in truth and know his word. And know his word. The people had an option. Jeroboam gave them their new gods. But the people have their own free will, just like you and I have our own free will. And Satan will come to you and he'll say, this is how you should worship God. And what he will do is recognize this. No one here, I'm sure, hasn't erected a golden calf in their room, in their living room, right? I hope not. But in a day and age in which things are a little different under the new covenant, things are spiritual. Jesus Christ says that we are called to worship him in spirit and truth and enter into his throne room, which is in heaven, where we have bold access. If Satan wants to hinder you from entering the throne room of God, how is he going to do what he's done here physically in the spiritual realm? Where does he raise up those spiritual idols? In your mind. He raises up a golden calf to distract us from the living God within our mind. We erect a God that it doesn't exist. What is one of the Ten Commandments? You shall worship the Lord your God. You shall worship no other God. But nowadays, people erect a God in their mind that is okay with their sin. And it is a very convenient God to worship. It is a very convenient God to worship. He erects these images of gold, but listen what the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 29 says. He tells us that, therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we shouldn't think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone or something shaped by art and man's devising. Or in the original Greek, in the original language, something that has been devised in the thoughts of our mind. That's what it says when you read it. He says, therefore, since we are the offspring of God, me and you are what? We are made in the image of God. If we are made in the image of God, how is it that we can think that the God of the universe, the God we serve, is a God that I can make up in my mind or a God that I can mold and form and put on a table? It can't. He's not. So he says, we're not to think that God or the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's thoughts or man's devising. It doesn't happen. You see, so what was one of Jeroboam's greatest worries? You see, in verse 28, he says, therefore, the king asked advice, not of God, made two calves of gold, and said to the people, look, it's too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Here are your gods, O Israel, which brought you up out of the land of Egypt. And he set up one in Bethel, and the other he put in Dan. And these gods, listen, these gods don't judge. They don't make any judgment upon your sin in your life. Neither do they speak. You guys, something that we have to be able to recognize our desire in our life, like I at the outset of the message, is conviction. We want a God that speaks loud and clear. Ryan's going on this tour, right? We're doing this high school tour like Scott was talking about. We get the first high school coming up. And the whole premise of this tour is what? Kill the noise. The kill the noise tour. Our lives can become very, very loud so that it drowns out the voice of God. I think that the church and the body of Christ needs to get back to prayer and fasting. Why? Because when we can set aside our Instagram or Twitter or Facebook, our desires of our flesh, maybe it's a certain sport that we spend more time with instead of God, maybe it's those things. If we can set those things aside and seek God through prayer and fasting with a true, genuine heart, we now what? We now begin to enter up into the throne room of God. Recognize what Jeroboam said. He says, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. You guys want to understand something? If you look at the back of your Bible and you look in the back of your Bible, it'll say 1 Kings chapter 12 and give you a map of what it looked like at that time of this kingdom split. In all reality, Jerusalem is actually lower on the map. But he says it's too inconvenient for you guys to go up. That's because when you always go to God, when you enter to the throne room of God to worship him, you always go up. And when we want to enter the throne room of God and worship him in truth, how do we go up? It's through prayer. It's through prayer where we can come to God. He removed that. Satan will make it in your life. He'll seek to remove prayer out of your life. He'll seek to remove fasting out of your life and seeking God out of your life so that you're not going up. In all reality, we end up going down. End up going down. I wrote it in my Bible. I penciled it in. I'll read it to you guys. It says, you always go up to Jerusalem where the temple's at. The temple, as Jesus said, should be what? A place of prayer, a house of prayer. But prayer, and hear me out, prayer is very inconvenient when you have X, Y, Z, whatever it is in your life to do. When you have X, Y, Z to do, it draws you up to the throne room of God where you can worship and praise him. Do you guys know that prayer and going up to the living God is very inconvenient? Not on the spirit, but upon your flesh. Your flesh does not want you to pray. Not only does your flesh not want you to pray, Satan wants nothing to do with the man or woman who is given over to praying and seeking the living God in truth. Not an image in your mind, not a picture on the wall, not the cross on your necklace. The true and living God, the invisible God that we serve, who reveals himself through his word. When you pray to that God, Satan loses ground, and he loses allegiance. And that is what Jeroboam was worried about. He was thinking, if they go to worship, they're going to go back to the other king. And this is Satan's aim. And so to hinder that from working, you guys see the parallel? Satan will do the same thing in your life. If Satan begins to lose a grip on you like Jeroboam felt he would, then he will seek to do as Jeroboam did and make it easy for you to still worship, but his way, which is not a way at all. We have to come to a place in our lives where we recognize this: God is holy, that God is holy. And when we choose to worship God according to the dictates of our own heart, I won't pray today, or I won't fellowship with the believers, I'll just do this. I can watch online, I don't really want to go out to fellowship with other people. And we start making up, and eventually we do this enough and we make up our own religion, just as Jeroboam did for the people. Just as he did for the people. And it's a scary thought. So we have to be able to examine ourselves, prove ourselves, to see where we're at. We continue to read in verse 29, he says, "And he set up one in Bethel, and the other he put in Dan. Now this thing became a sin for the people." Why? "Because they went to worship before the one as far as Dan. He made shrines on the high places and made priests from every class of people who were not of the sons of Levi." So he's just setting his whole thing up, something that God did not devise, a religion and a relationship with God that he has not ordained, that God has not approved of. This is what the Bible says about going up to Jerusalem, coming to God and raising the standard, raising the bar in your life, and not making things easy. The Bible tells us that many people shall come and say, "Come and let us go up to the mountain of God, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, and we shall walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem." The Lord was to be sought in Jerusalem. But now, like I said, the Bible says, like Jesus says, we're called to worship him in spirit and in truth. What is the parallel? What is the blessing? What is the goodness that we can draw from this text out of our own lives? Well, we go to John chapter 4. And what does it tell us? And you guys can turn there with me. We go to John chapter 4, and we know the relationship that Jesus, or the conversation that Jesus is having with this woman. She's a woman, a Samaritan woman, who doesn't know the Lord, who is lost, just like some of us in the world, just like some of us in here today. Sometimes we're a little confused. There's a lot of noise in our life. And Satan has offered you an alternative way to worship, which is not a way of worshiping at all. We have the blessing now, guys, here in 2015, where we don't have to come into this building, though it is I highly encourage it. We don't have to come into this building to seek the face of God. We can go straight to him because Jesus died on the cross for us, and he's made that path, that way to come to him. But what does he say? He's speaking to this woman, and we read here in verse 11, "The woman said to him, 'Sir, you have nothing to draw with.'" She asked for water. He asked for water. "And the well is deep. Where then do you get this water you're talking about, this living water? Are you greater than our father, Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Woman, if you drink of this water, what? You're going to thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I gave him will never thirst, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." You'll never thirst for the things of this world again, lady. I'm having this dialogue. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water that I may never thirst again. Now come here to draw." And Jesus said, "Go call your husband and come here." Then the woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, "You have well said, you have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you are now with is not even your husband, and that you spoke truly." Then she says, "Okay, what?" The woman said, "Okay, so I perceive that you're a prophet. You know things from God. I think you know what's up. Our fathers worshipped," and this is where we're getting to the gist of it. He says, "Our fathers worshipped on this mountain. And you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me. And he says the same to you and you and I today here in the sanctuary. "Man or woman, whoever you may be, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither worship in this mountain nor in Jerusalem. worship the Father. He says, you worship what you don't know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. We have this free access. If God's desire is that we would worship him in spirit and truth, what does this mean? It means that there must be in your life and my life a genuine, a real conversion where we now live with the Spirit of God within us. Isn't it one of the greatest mysteries? Isn't it very difficult to even imagine and fathom that the God who's created all things, the God of the universe, desires to live inside of you, desires to live within you? That is one of the greatest mysteries. I think a lot of times within our mind, we take that for granted. But it's only with that God living inside of you that you can actually see things and perceive them in truth. We live in a day and age where a lie is what people eat up, right? Turn on the news, turn on television, talk to your friends, and a lie proceeds out of their mouth. Why? Because just like, remember Rehoboam, their allegiance was to him. Our friends and our family in the world, their allegiance, though they may not know it, they're enslaved and their allegiance is to their father, Jesus says it himself, the devil, who propagates a lie where Jesus said what? That Satan himself is the father of lies. In him, there is no truth. In him, there is no truth. And we know these things. We know these things. We've studied these things. But yet, why is it so many times that we are so wayward? And we find ourselves deviating from our prayer life, going up to God, and we find ourselves going downward, seeking God according to our own heart, which isn't a way at all, and we're following after Satan. But he says, God is seeking for them to worship him in spirit and in truth. Be filled with the God of the universe within you by turning from sin. God offers you something so great. One of the greatest things God offers you is for him to dwell within you. He says, if you would but just turn from a life of sin, I will give you my Holy Spirit. Then he says what? In spirit and in truth. And where is it that we receive our truth in our lives? There has to be a balance. We have to be men and women who are spiritually minded, putting on the mind of Christ, thinking of the things of the Spirit. But then we must be men and women of the Word of God, for it is where we get our greatest source of truth. Our greatest source of truth. From the day you were born to the day you die, you will be offered by the enemy an alternative way, an easier way of worshiping and following after God, always. You and I, like I said, have to be able to discern and recognize when the enemy places it before you. So that when you see it, you have those special eyeballs for when he offers you that glitter, like we talked about, that glittery calf, or that career path, which looks so amazing. Where Satan says, this is a beautiful career path. This is what I'm calling you. This is what God's calling you to do, when in reality, he's not. He says, this is it. Follow it. If you don't have discernment and we don't know the Lord within our own heart, within our own mind, we don't know his word, the Bible says that we will easily be swept away into going into that which is going to bring us money fast, which is easy, which is going to possibly maybe bring us fame, bring us notoriety, all these things, and make our life very comfortable and easy. Guys, remember, the Bible says this home, this place where we live, this earth, it's not our home. That the sufferings of this world, if we experience any of them, that the sufferings of this world can't be compared with what we're going to receive in heaven. That's what the Bible tells us. Now the question is, do you believe this? And the way I would know in my own life if I believe this is that when trials and temptations, when difficulty comes, I don't take the easy route. because I know that the easy route is in time to come, where there will be no more tears, there will be no more suffering in heaven. There'll be no more tears, no more suffering in heaven. Worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Throughout your whole life, you have this opportunity. We have this opportunity. Go ahead and turn your Bibles back to 1 Kings. So he has set up this false religion. And we read in verse 31, he made shrines on high places and made priests from every class of people who were not of the sons of Levi. He is disobeying the command of the Lord. Who is it in the Bible where that we recognize did this very thing? He raised up for himself a false religion, and he offered sacrifices on an altar where he was never called to do it. You remember Saul. Saul was waiting for Samuel to come and offer a sacrifice before they went out to battle. He got impatient and says, whatever, I'll light it up myself. Samuel comes and he brings judgment upon him because of his disobedience. For God, the God that we serve, is a God of order. The God that we serve is a God of order. He is laid out for us. If you were here this morning, our pastor was speaking in Romans chapter 11. And in Romans chapter 11, it says what? Oh, the depths both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. The God that we serve knows all things. He has all wisdom and all knowledge. That is a person, is a leader that I want to follow, whatever he says to do. Do you guys understand and know this? Jeroboam, who's this king who is leading the people into idol worship, was actually given a promise by God. God promised him that if you would keep my commandments, your heart would be bent towards me and you would follow after me. He said it with his God. The God of the universe said, I will raise up for you a dynasty like King David. What a promise. What a promise. God will raise us up in time to come to sit with him, to be with him. If we would just but listen, as Jeroboam decided not to. Remember, these things are written for our example. And he raises up his own priests who are not of the sons of Levi, who don't have the authority to do it. And he even ordained a feast. The Bible says, verse 32, Jeroboam ordained a feast on the 15th day of the 8th month, like the feast that was in Judah, and offered sacrifices on the altar. The true feast that God ordained, that God has given the nation of Israel, was on the 15th day in the 7th month. So now, this is what the enemy loves to do. He likes to mock. The enemy likes to take what God has made, what God has ordained, and twist it. We know this. And twist it to his own fashion so that he could point his proverbial finger at God and say, look what I'm doing, look what I have. But he's a copycat and he twists. And so here's Jeroboam. He's raised up these random people. Oh, yeah, you can give a sacrifice. And he's raised up this day of feasting so that the nation of Israel, you don't have to go to Israel and have the feast there. You don't have to go to Israel and worship there. Here's a false God. And here's a feast that you can do here too. Where do we do that in our own lives? And you're only able to answer that question yourself. What are the things that please God? You know, that is one of my greatest prayers when I wake up or throughout my day. God, what pleases you? What is pleasing to you? The Bible says that the will of God is this, that we believe on what? On his son, Jesus Christ. This is the will of God. But then practically living out a life that pleases him, how do I know it? How do I seek that out? It's through the word constantly. And so he's raised up this false religion. So he did. Listen, it says again in verse 32, the 15th day of the 8th month, like the feast that was in Judah, and he offered sacrifices on the altar. So he did at Bethel, sacrificing to the calves that he had made. And at Bethel, he installed the priest of the high places, which he had made. So he made offerings on the altar, which he had made at Bethel, on the 15th day of the 8th month, which he had devised in his own heart. And he ordained a feast for the chosen of Israel and offered sacrifices on the altar and burned incense. He has committed a horrible, complete abomination in the eyes of God. Guys, this is my encouragement to you this day. And I pray that it would take effect in your life in truth. God has given us from Genesis to Revelation the complete, listen, redemptive story of mankind to redeem men. Your heart and my heart are constantly bent towards doing that which displeases God. Which displeases God. But the God that we serve is a God of redemption. We have to always remember that. And what God wants to do in your life is to redeem back the time that Satan has stolen in your life and that you have squandered. Let us not be lazy. Let us not cast off our first love for something of a base that is of base value. There is a higher life, so to speak. There is a higher life to be lived, a higher standard. And though we never measure up to the standard, Christ is the only one. When we submit to him and walk after him in faith, he lifts us up to be with him. And we don't succumb to the things of this world. That has to be the aim of the church today. We can leave this chapel, we can leave this place, look out into the world and say, it is so messed up, it is so dark. But unless we do something about it, and turning from the God of our mind, and turning from a God who doesn't exist, and turning to the God of the Bible, the God of the universe, who I think is calling his church out loud and clear, whether it's from this pulpit through Bible studies, whether it's in dreams that I believe God speaks to people, whoever it may be by, God is calling us out. If you're here on Sundays, first Sundays of the month, we have prayer meetings, right? They're amazing. They're awesome. A constant theme that I've seen in the past 5-6 years is if God is giving a prophecy through somebody or a word of wisdom or a word of knowledge, we are continually hearing what? Come out of the world. Come out of the world. Don't worship these false gods. They had it physically in their time to see it. How much more sly and tricky is the enemy to raise up an image of God that is not an image at all? This is one of his greatest tricks. Isn't this what the Bible says the enemy is going to do in the tribulation period? Right? The Antichrist is going to raise himself up. Satan's going to raise up the Antichrist and do what? Deceive, if even possible, the elect. And to telling people what? I am God. He is the one to come. He is the Messiah. Worship me. Some people do, some people don't. The world that we're living in now is being primed, being set up. As they are worshiping false idols in the land of Israel, the enemy is allowing us to worship these smaller idols in and through our lives every day so that in time to come, when the man of sin is revealed, it'll be easy. And we'll be easy prey. We got to understand, the world that we live in is a world where Satan rules. This is his backyard. It's his backyard where he is putting pieces of his puzzle in places. But remember this, greater is he who is in you, if we are walking and serving God in spirit and in truth, greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. We have nothing to fear. We have nothing to fear. And we could approve of that, and we do. But unless we truly trust in God and believe it by faith and turn from our wicked ways, nothing will happen. One of the enemy's greatest lies is to puff you and I up with truth. It's for us to go ahead and read the Bible. But when we don't live it out in our daily lives, following after God, our high priest, the King of Kings, practically and doing it and living out the word of God, what happens? Just like sin, when you deny the Holy Spirit pressing upon your mind, it becomes easier and easier not to live a life of virtue, not to live a life of holiness, not to live a life of dignity. It comes easier and easier, and Satan goes like this. They are professing with their mouth one thing, but they're living another, and that other is following after a false god. I pray that you guys, as you go about your day, that you would be able to check the recesses of your mind. When the Bible says sin lies at the door and its desire is for you, and when it is before your eyes, when it is right there, and you have the option to worship something that isn't true and to give into it or to worship the living God, I pray that before you, that you would have the power within you, the power of God, to be able to deny it and choose this day whom you will serve. Whom you will serve. Because I'm going to ask the band to come out, because I completely believe that God within my own spirit has caused me to say what he's willed for me to say. And I pray that today would be something new for each and every one of us. Jesus says that his yoke is easy. It is light. I'm not talking about a worshiping of God that is difficult, that it better be difficult or it's not real. No, because we are saved by what? We're saved by faith. By grace alone, God has paved the way so that we don't have to live by works. There is a contrast. What I'm speaking about today, and I pray that God would, even as he convicted my heart as I studied this, is that when we are truly reading the Word of God or praying, that we wouldn't have a false idea, that our minds would be so warped and brainwashed with the Spirit of God that I have confidence in whom I am praying to. There's been times in my life where I have prayed and I really, within my heart, have no clue who I'm praying. I feel like my prayers are coming off the ceiling. The Bible says, seek God while he can be found. He has placed everybody here in the area where you live before the foundations of the world. He's appointed everybody's dwelling place. So that where you're at, the Bible says, so that you can grope out and reach out for God and find him. He's allowed you in your circumstances, in your life, where you're at, to know him in truth. Don't think for a minute, because I don't live in a foreign land where there's Christian persecution, or I don't live in this place where I have this freedom. No, God has placed everybody strategically through his sovereignty in a place where they can find him and know him in spirit and in truth. And if that's you today and you've lived a life completely contrary to the word of God, living a life that maybe you thought you were worshiping the true and living God, but you're in a place where you kind of don't know, today can be the day where God reveals himself to you. I'm going to ask the band to play and I'm going to pray for you guys. And I'm not going to ask anybody to come forward. I'm going to pray. As a matter of fact, let's all stand. We're going to worship the Lord. And as we worship, I just want you within your own mind to check your heart. The Bible says constantly check your heart. And I believe that through the power of the Holy Spirit, God can speak to you in regards to who you worship, whether it's self, whether it's a false idea of God, where it's easy for you to worship, where it's easy for you to live your life, because the God that you serve doesn't convict you, doesn't condemn the sin that you live in. God is holy, guys. God is holy. We must remember that. Remember this and allow that to draw you to worship him, to praise him and thank him for his grace and his mercy, which is unending. I don't think we can completely understand and exhaust it, because we can't. But this example, this encouragement, let it stick in your mind and stick in your heart all the days of your life.